What is video game crime jazz? Well, you know, it's just jazz that's played behind criminals often in video games. It never occurred to me that people would just make a subgenre of just like, you know, regular jazz as crime jazz. And I'm, you know, literally studying jazz composition in a university right now. And on the surface level, I think, you know, most jazz players would just say, well, that's just jazz music. But after listening and thinking about it, I think there are some distinctions that can be made for all of these tracks to kind of collectively share a sound together a little bit, even though it's just jazz. When listening to some of this crime jazz from video games, for me it sounds like a small deviation from spy jazz from like a lot of famous movie scores. The sound that's like commonly found throughout James Bond and the Incredible series. They both happen to be in like a minor key and have like a low key feeling to them, but also have an intense like action. I think the differences between these two, while small, can be heard in how they use the melody. I think spy music tends to be a bit more pattern or motif based than regular jazz music, at least when it comes to like the actual song or compositions themselves. Usually when you have a blues form, usually one motif is kind of expanded upon within 12 bars. But you have to take into consideration that spy jazz is kind of a product of movie scoring. So a lot of the composers, the goal isn't to make a standalone song. It's there to complement what's happening on the screen. Because these movies tend to be, you know, action-based, they go from like slow to fast to moderate and a, you know, very fast pace because of the movie. They don't have time to build up a theme over 8 bars and really try to like build up melodic interest slowly. And the first 28 seconds of the Incredible song, we've already alternated between four different sections. Compared to the Count Basie song Splanky, after 35 seconds, they've only crossed over an intro and just barely finished the first section of the song. Now, of course, this isn't some like exclusive rule. The James Bond theme has a slow entrance, but when it does get into the full song, it starts to move kind of fast between the sections, like the Incredible song. I'm just speaking for general observations I've made, because at the end of the day, spy jazz is jazz, and the line of separation between regular jazz and quote unquote spy jazz isn't always going to be clear. It's, you know, really blurry, similar to how modern rap and modern trap have kind of really started to blend together. So you really can't make a very solid distinction between the two, but you can point out some cliches like the ones that I'm pointing out now. I've heard this little riff in almost every spy movie I've watched. You also hear this progression a lot too. It's just a minor chord, but usually the root or the seventh note is moving between half steps, and it's a cool way to add tension and movement to the chords while also feeling a little bit stagnant, because just one note is moving, but just one note is enough to change, moderately change the feeling of what's happening. And the cool thing is too, is you end up with a minor major seventh chord if you keep doing that, right? It's a cool sound, and I've heard one of my music professors refer to this as the spy chord, because it's one of those things that, you know, if you're making a spy soundtrack, you almost have to have this type of chord within the soundtrack, right? Coming back to the video game crime tracks, which again is just regular jazz for the most part, it often switches from having a really improv-based song to having some that's closer to like, you know, jazz standards. These tracks don't really have any set melody. They don't even have a lot of piano either. It's usually just bass drums and an instrument that's improvising, usually trumpet. It's a very interesting texture. Usually the piano is there in the ensemble to fill up the rest of the notes between the chord and make everything sound a bit fuller. But only having bass and drums makes things feel kind of empty, but that's not necessarily a bad thing. A lot of times, this texture, when played at a fast tempo, often sounds more intense than it would be with a piano in it. And my theory behind it is maybe excluding the piano brings more attention to the rhythm of the bass and the drums. So the way how things works in the jazz rhythm section, and usually in a lot of other rhythm sections too, is that the bass is the foundation of the group. Because the bass is a pitched information and it's in a low register, it gives us our harmonic information because it's often playing the root of the chords or the lowest note of the chord, right? But because it's so low, it also has a percussive effect and often establishes the main groove of the song. And the way how it works is the bass sends harmonic information to the piano and the bass sends rhythmic information to the drummer. And while both of those are kind of displayed through the bass itself, by removing the extra harmonic information of the piano, you're just left with more rhythm than harmony. So I think, you know, that helps explain a bit of why it might feel more intense or a bit more driving without the piano, because you're just, most of what you're hearing and listening to is rhythm versus it being more balanced with harmony and rhythm. The piano can also be, you know, percussive, but the harmonic information of the piano tends to still stand at the forefront when you listen to it in a lot of occasions. An improvised instrument then balances out, you know, what's happening with the drum and the bass and just amplifies the intensity. You might be wondering, okay, so why has this become so common within crime soundtracks for video games? Why have they chosen this format? And to find the answer for that, I think we should look back to one of the biggest figures known in jazz, Miles Davis. Miles Davis recorded the soundtrack for a French movie on the days of December 4th and 5th of 1957. It was a really bold and groundbreaking choice at the time. While jazz has been used in films at the time, the cool thing about this soundtrack is that it was all improvised. There were no set songs or melodies, and everything was done on the moment with very little pre-planning, if any. They had a screen playing in front of them with the movie showing, and they would play music on the spot befitting the scene based on what they were watching. There wasn't anything that was written down. These musicians had just came up with stuff on the spot. And a lot of these songs are really good. You know, I played them in my own time, and I still admittedly haven't seen the movie. But when you listen to these soundtracks, you can hear obvious influence of the instrumentation and the direction with some of these songs, right? Like, you pull up this one Miles Davis soundtrack and it's literally, you know, drums, bass, and trumpet improvised. I feel like a lot of composers for these shows and games had heard this and kind of tried to recreate the rawness that Miles Davis had. So it ended up becoming somewhat of a cliche or a staple type of format to use. Miles Davis didn't invent this format, of course, but I don't think we should understate the value he had in pushing it and its use for media. Crime jazz itself is just an umbrella term for jazz that people often associate with, you know, media. The type of crime jazz before I talked about with Miles Davis is only a snapshot at like a specific sound in that term, right? Because if you listen to something from like Lupin the Third, and I think that's considered crime jazz, but it doesn't necessarily fit within that same form, right? Because you have a lot of big band scores, a lot of involvement, and a lot of things that are written out and very particular within the scores, but these still give off a certain vibe that I feel like helps to capture that crime jazz feeling. And I think that's shown within a little bit of the Persona franchise. The biggest common denominator that all of these songs have are like they're in some type of minor key, which gives it a bit of more edge, right? And all of these examples I've shown before cover jazz from a more classic swing era, with, you know, acoustic bass and the drums playing in a classic swing pattern. But when you listen to Persona 5, it still carries that crime jazz feeling, but does it in a very modern way. The style of jazz Persona used is classified as, you know, acid jazz. It's a combination of funk, jazz, soul, and rock, and, you know, a couple of other things. And for me, when I think of crime jazz, it's either the really intense, like fast-paced stuff, or the more mellow and smoother type of stuff, right? And while Persona does both well and does a lot of things really good with its soundtrack, I'm usually thinking more about the mellow and smoother tracks in Persona 5 when I'm thinking about crime jazz. Of course, this music is still in a minor key. But the cool thing, I think, is the use of the Fender Rhodes. The Rhodes piano is a type of legendary electric piano, and this piano's sine waves are extremely clean compared to a regular piano's notes. so clean to the point where it just feels like everything blends together better to create a more lush sound, even if you're playing the same chords between a regular piano and an electric piano, right? But even then, when we look at series like Cowboy Bebop and Lupin the Third and Persona and all of these other series, I think the best way to kind of help describe crime jazz is that it's more about the show than it is the music in certain, you know, ways. And don't get me wrong, there's a lot of cool things with Persona's music, like how they transform old swing into like a modern groove, which you can check out in my Spy X Family video, or the funky bass lines and the smooth chords. But I think the most illuminating factor for the music being called crime jazz is the fact that we're playing as a phantom thief. You know, all of these shows, Cowboy Bebop, you know, Persona 5, and, you know, Lupin the Third, they have a very specific themes and characteristics that follow it that, you know, if you were to listen to this song by itself without these characters, I doubt that it would necessarily get the same title. And I feel like we always talk about how much the music influences how we see media, but I think this is one of those examples of how the media influences how we listen to music. Most of what we know as crime jazz is just from, you know, being conditioned to interpret things a certain way, because we often hear this riff played with spy movies, it makes us think spy. But the lick itself doesn't have anything inherently to do with spies, but these are just cliches that... But cliches are very important in order to build an identity within your music and some type of continuity. And if you want to hear more cliches with the Nintendo's franchises and Mario, check out this video right here. I would really appreciate it if you guys help me get to 1,000 subscribers. And thank you very much for watching this video.